Hey, everybody. Happy whatever day. Happy December. It's beautiful December. I'm taking the month off. It is a multimedia month. I am putting out product. Thank you, everyone who subscribed to my vlog. I was focusing a lot of energy on my vlog lately. But I backed off this week because I was having a disconnected feeling in life. And so I'm posting one right now. I'm editing it. It is Friday in my world. The girls are going to Disney on Ice tonight, and I am hanging out at home. So I'm going to edit a vlog. I'll post it this evening. Ta-da, ta-da. I had on this vlog, the one that I'm posting, I had dinner with Push and Tom, Christina Pajinski and Tom Segura with my wife. And I brought my camera. We filmed just a little bit because life has to be real. And you don't want to just have a camera in everyone's face. And Push is giving birth Monday. So she is 9 months pregnant. We had a great dinner. That is on that. Today's podcast, I have nothing to promote, everybody. Just go to my website. Go to Bert.com. Buy someone a machine shirt. If you know a Russian person, get them that for Christmas, for Hanukkah. Or get my book, Life of the Party. Send it to someone for Christmas. Today's podcast is a different type of podcast. It is something I've wanted to do for a very long time, and serendipitously, it kind of fell into my lap. My wife has a book club. They read books. Unbeknownst to me, the book my wife was reading was part of her book club. I got so interested in it that I read it. I also spoke about this book on Rogan's podcast. The name of the book is So You've Been Publicly Shamed. Is that it?
Yes.
And Leanna's here because today's podcast is me sitting in on her book club and talking about the book So You've Been Publicly Shamed. I think we've all been very fascinated by the concept of these social justice warriors and the type of people they are. And this book kind of delves into how we become those people and why we have leniencies or tendencies to become outraged. Something that comics focus on a lot. I talked at length with Ari Shaffir about this book when I was in New York. We went out to lunch and we talked about this book nonstop, and I mentioned it on Rogan. So in today's podcast, and if you like this, we will do more of it. If you don't like it, just keep it to yourself. in today's podcast, it is me, Leanne's friend Kathy, who's sitting next to me.
Colleen. Lynn.
Kirsten.
Sandy.
And Sandy. Sandy's the one with the heavy Asian accent.
She's not that heavy.
Agree to disagree. So that's today's podcast. So if you like it, let us know, and we'll do more of them. I had a really good time. The next books they're reading are Seabiscuit and Lord of the Flies. So that's today's podcast. My wife has something she'd like to say.
I would. You know, it is awesome if you don't have time to actually sit down and read for your book club, Bert Kreischer.
Yeah.
You could download one or both of these books at audible.com.
That's audiobooks, correct?
Yes. What did I say?
No, I'm just asking. If you don't like to read, audiobooks.
Yes. And today's sponsor for this podcast is audible.com, and they have more than 180,000 audiobooks and spoken word audio products.
The good book to get would be this one.
Would be.
It's almost like a podcast. Any of Malcolm Gladwell's books are fantastic. And I know a guy, Bert Kreischer, who wrote a book called Life of the Party. You can get that at audible.com.
You certainly
can. It's even better than my book because I read it personally, and I lose my fucking mind throughout it. So if you want to listen to me have panic attacks and fucking rage issues, listen to me. And my buddy Omar Dorsey, because I wrote the N-word in my book, and I didn't want to say it, so I had him come over and say it for me. Keep going, Leanne.
So this is how you get a free audiobook of your choice. You go to www.audiblepodcast.com/Bertcast.
And you get a free audiobook.
Free. Your first one, I think, is free.
Get one. Go get a free audiobook. Get this book. Actually, I take that back. If you enjoy this, get the next book we're about to read. Get that audiobook.
Seabiscuit.
And then
you should get Seabiscuit, Bert.
I'll get Seabiscuit on audible.com/Bertcast, and I'll get my free book, and it'll be Seabiscuit. And then in 2 weeks when we talk about Seabiscuit, we can all be up to pace. And as you will hear, I will ask if you have questions for the next book. I give away a Twitter address that Leanne is not super fond of. Keep listening. This is more than a book club, guys. This is a very funny podcast. I think you will really enjoy this because it's me and Leanne's friends, and I take over the book club, and it gets deep.
And I have fantastic friends.
And you do have fantastic friends.
I have cool chick friends.
Anything else?
I think that's it. Just audiblepodcast.com/Bertcast.
And thank you, Audible, for sponsoring this podcast. We love that you make this possible. So that's it. listen, if the levels are bad, if the audio is a little bad, I'll work on it for next time. I'm thinking about getting a board and miking everyone when we do one of these so that it would be pretty legit. But it was six people, so I put just the room mic on. But it's fun. I think you'll enjoy it. And you learned something today. It's kind of cool. I like this. I hope you guys like it too. Have a great weekend. Be safe. Don't drink and drive. And we will see you guys. Was that, was anything? Okay. All right. Enjoy the podcast, everybody.
This is
She's got all the questions too. Is my guess.
She's got all the questions.
I didn't prepare any questions for Seabiscuit.
No, but I'm sure she did.
Well, we could talk about Seabiscuit. Oh, yeah, she is here. Sure. So pause the talk. Well,
oh, I don't really want to discuss that because I'm in the middle of reading that.
Do you want to wait? She had
I haven't finished.
Call her on the phone. With all the technology we have.
Slow down with this book club thing. No, like I can't catch up with your reading.
But yeah. I did make this time.
English is my second language.
It is. That's why
I can't read.
I don't think we're going. I think we go too slow. But this is the one time.
This is the one time. I think it was just a busy time.
No.
Does someone want to call Kirsten on the phone and talk to her and say,
why
hey?
Why is your flashlight on?
Because, and you know what? Let's lose the gameplay we got going on here.
I thought it was too fast, too, given everything that was going on.
Well, it was because of the holidays.
Yes,
it was.
Thought we should meet during the break. That's what I thought we should do.
Oh, yeah, that would
have been good. But I was following Kirsten.
Well, we can discuss the Kirsten's shaming book, and then
it's
the next one, right?
And there she is.
The next one.
Am I? Oh, that's what I thought of Priscilla.
She's here.
What's wrong?
Is it wrong?
You okay?
Yeah. You had that look like the dog attacked
you.
It was
just laughing. I don't
know if they're huge. They're huge, right? We left you the pole position. Would you like some coffee?
No, thank you.
You sure? Orange juice?
You need to say that a couple more times. We're not totally comfortable with how late you've been.
Bert. Oh, you should hear Bert. Oh, gosh.
All right, screw it. The Wi-Fi is on.
Going today for your class to Holiday?
Yeah.
What time do you guys
go? I don't know. I'm only going for one.
You're late.
Leftover money after shopping and lecture got a ton.
We're recording this, just giving you a heads up. I'm going to do this for my podcast this week. This is our book club. Do we want to go around the room and introduce ourselves?
No.
You know what? It's better if you don't say your names.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that way, if you say something racist, Lynn... We can
right.
No one will, what?
Right, exactly.
You don't want to be publicly shamed?
No, so yeah. I don't want to say my name.
Sandy, I hate to say this, but when you speak, everyone will know it's you. All right, you ready?
I'm Susie Wong.
Fakey make believe.
Fakey
make believe.
I'm Susie Wong, age 35.
Good. All right, who are you running book club? Kirsten?
We're talking about you.
So you've been publicly shamed?
Spot, yes.
Okay, good. Do you want a microphone to do this?
Look at her.
There's a mic here.
Out.
There's a mic right here, and I can hear everything.
I know. She's on top of it.
Because I had no questions about Seabiscuit. But a lot of people haven't finished Seabiscuit.
No.
So should we
push it?
Wait. Would you like us to wait?
I'm fine with waiting.
Well, we're probably not going to meet until what? Until break.
Yeah.
I'll get lottery in time.
Maybe we should pick her next book.
No, it's fine.
Okay. No, because I'm ready to read.
Hey, guys, we're losing listeners. I know, Sandy. Sandy, me and you are sitting here dying here.
I guess.
Yeah. All right. Kirsten.
Let's start with Kirsten, the name of the book, the author.
The name of the book is So You've Been Publicly Shamed, and the author is John Ronson.
John Ronson also wrote the book Men Who Stare at Goats.
Yes. Oh, really? He did? Yeah.
Well, I only read that. From the book, Sandy. Did you not read the book? He says,
no,
at the very beginning.
I didn't finish the book, I have to be honest.
Sorry, guys. I'm saying, really.
You and Sam Fisher.
Our English is not my primary focus.
Not your primary focus?
No, it's not. What is your primary focus?
Chinese.
Fakey make believe.
It's your primary focus. It's harder for me to read. I'm not a fast reader.
So just if we're all going
to
be honest right here, where did you get to in the book?
God. Page 4. No.
Do you know who Justine Sacco is?
Yes.
Okay, then that's good enough.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All right, did you write out questions?
Well, I printed up something from online, but frankly, I thought that hers was the most interesting story because some of them, the one about, I don't remember the guy's name, but who who fabricated the Dylan quote.
Yeah.
It was such a minor and infinitesimal thing, and I get how journalistically speaking you can't do that. So I kind of got both of their perspectives. I got the, you know, the journalist who outed him on that, but I also was like, oh, it was such a little thing. But the Justine Sacco I thought was more interesting because I remember that happening, and I remember thinking, oh, what a stupid bitch. Like, I had that.
Wait, did
feeling.
You publicly shame her? You did, I mean, did you?
Yeah.
Well, that's most fascinating thing of all this is that in reading this book, I was on a plane, and a woman, I don't know if I told you this or not, Leanne, but I might have told you guys, a man wanted to sit next to his daughter, and he asked two people to change, and they ignored him. He said, I'm sorry, can you guys please, do you mind if I sit next to my daughter, who's like, I think six, do you mind if I sit next to my daughter? They're in first class, both of them in first class seats. And they're both just went. They're just aisle, which is coveted. And he's like, "Do you guys mind if you guys could switch and my daughter and I could sit next to each other?" And they didn't say anything. They literally sat there, and this woman just sat there, just staring straight ahead. And then I said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa! Hold on 1 second." And now I'm in first class too. I go, "I will easily change with either of you. I have an aisle seat. If either of you want my seat, I'll take this little girl's seat." And then that's when the woman goes, "Oh, okay, I'll take your seat." And I got so fucking enraged. But I'm reading this book, and I start taking pictures of the back of her head. And I'm like, I have pictures of her, and I'm like, I'm going to put this online and put her on blast. And then halfway through, I'm like, have I learned nothing? Like, clearly, yeah. I'm just part of the fucking witch hunt to find people that are. It's a social justice warrior,
mm-hmm. yeah.
And I don't want to be that. Mm-hmm. And I was like, but I'm so mad.
Yeah.
And then I was like, well, if I've learned with being mad, especially when I'm drunk, is that if you breathe and wait, the next day you're like, what was I mad about? So like, I just didn't do the picture. I still have it on my phone. But I didn't send the picture, but in reading this. And so then I started, all I could think as I read this book was, how culpable am I of public shaming?
Yes.
Leah?
Me too.
What I thought of when I was reading this book was, what is the psychological base of this problem? What is wrong with society that's what society is doing now? There's something wrong with, is it a lack of community, a lack of fellowship? Is it a lack of, like, cohesion as people? Is it... What is it?
It's a lack of problems, I think. We don't have a war, we don't have anything, a depression going on. We don't have a major event to focus on, I think.
I don't know.
Because, I mean, back then we talk about the war, we talk about, there's other things to worry about besides publicly shaming someone.
I think it's also like a short attention span thing. Like, we're such a, like, you know, I'm looking at this on my phone, I'm doing this, like, we're multitasking, we're like, da-da-da-da-da. So it's like a knee-jerk reaction kind of thing. Because for me, I just read that one thing, I don't know anything about her, I'm not on Twitter, so I wasn't part of the public shaming, like, in terms of putting it out there. But my reaction was just like, oh, what a dumb bitch. I didn't even think about it again. I mean, maybe I said something to Richard, like, just like, oh, who would do that? But, like, there was definitely an undertone of, if I was on Twitter, I probably would have commented on it, but I'm not. So I felt like I'm definitely part of the problem, even though I wasn't putting it out there. For me, it was like a short attention span thing. It was like, I saw it, gross. And then reading the book, I was like, oh, of course there's another side to this. Of course. Like,
well, and also it's very easy for someone to do it, just pressing a button.
And there's no repercussions. Like, you can say whatever you want, and nobody holds you accountable. I think that's part of the problem.
Exactly.
They can say horrific, degrading things, and nobody says, nobody held the person who said she should be raped by an AIDS patient or whatever. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, nobody's mad at that person. That's horrific.
Yeah.
You don't say that.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
That doesn't get to play.
No.
To you. That doesn't end up in your hand. Like, it's all about being in your hand. Everything shows up in your hand. Offense shows up in your hand. So, it's like, as opposed to seeing it in a billboard or even on
television.
It just touched you. It just molested you with offense. Like, whoa, 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 this is my little private thing. And those ones, you just don't see
well,
them.
Well, for her, she's the one who made the AIDS comment, right?
Yeah.
Do you know exactly what she said?
She said, heading to Africa, I hope I don't get AIDS. Just kidding. LOL, I'm white.
Okay, but this is what I think, that there are a lot of people that come across to me as very holier than thou and think that it makes them feel good to be able to say something bad about them. Because how many people do you think criticized her but have also made equally racist and more horrible jokes in their own, amongst their friends or...
self-righteousness.
Self-righteousness. And you see it on Facebook all the time. It's like,
yes.
Yeah. People just jump on this bandwagon anytime something comes up, and it's just like, who are you? But you're so fabulous that you have a right to be condemning this person, when I guarantee if I nitpicked your life, you're probably not the most honest or moral person, and you've probably had done a lot of bad shit too. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm not a religious person, but in a lot of stuff that happens, I find myself going back to quotes from the Bible, like, what is it, the one without sin cast the first stone or something?
Yeah.
We all have,
right?
Like, exactly what you're saying. So I wonder, again, what I was saying, lack of fellowship, a lack of some kind of system that you hold on to, religion or Buddhism or whatever it is, doesn't give you the right barometer for you in your place in the world as a bigger picture, you know, because we are all connected whether we like it or not.
Well, that,
and my actions affect everybody to some extent, but that doesn't seem to be the way people feel anymore. You know, you are now a pariah because
right.
you made a mistake. So
that's true, but like the book talks all about the history, and there's a long history of public shaming. Do you know what I mean? Like, that was the punishment for lots of things, was
right.
to be publicly shamed. And, you know, historically, there was much more of a sense of community. You know, towns were smaller.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't this
it's
massive
true.
Communication.
Yes.
Like, everybody was
yeah.
significantly more connected.
Yeah. yeah.
And people still felt that was the way.
That's true.
Yeah, in fact,
kind of ebbs and flows,
yeah.
right? You go
yeah.
in and out of that kind of mindset. And I guess from what I got, what I understood when I read it, was that when you're in that kind of punitive place of public shaming, that the general mentality of the public is not as dynamic, right? It's a pretty simple mentality as a whole. Isn't that what? Did I read that right?
Well, these are also the things that stuck out with me. First of all, the number one is no accountability. And what you said, there's no accountability for the person that writes the rape joke versus about Justine Sacco versus Justine Sacco. There was no accountability for her, but she was in the first generation. I don't know, you guys are not familiar with this, but I am, only because it's my business. She was in the first generation of, I'm going to say it bluntly, but like funny chicks on Twitter who were about to become famous. In this list was this girl, Slash Lean, Jenny High Five, Johnson, Samantha Molan, or Jenny Molan. There were a bunch of women, Kelly Oxford, who exploded at this time, and all they were just pretty women who were really funny, and it was, and they proved just how funny women were, but it was like a wave of this, and she was trying to be a part of that. I believe they were outrageous. The one joke Kelly Oxford said that I remember was, that I loved and I asked you about, was women who enjoy pads love smelling their menstruation. And I just thought it was
that's disgusting, but it's not a joke.
Like, if I go, I will watch this.
That's not a joke. That's just
shock.
Okay, yeah.
And all. It's disgusting.
Bert, do you know her, of her before you
she's
read
just
I found,
this?
Who? Justine Sacco? No. She was, that tweet came out when all this was happening. So there are a lot of women, there are a lot of people too. The men as well, but like, people too. There's a lot of women who, that was their thing. They were attractive. They were funny as shit, and they started getting followings and book deals and sitcom deals, and they were punching up scripts because they were so funny. So she was in that first group of being outrageous on Twitter.
So she was
she
a reporter,
right?
Is she a reporter?
No,
she's
a publicist.
A publicist.
But there was no, but that was
but
the
was,
that
was
the mandate.
Was
that
yeah.
was the mandate. Oh, so the attempt was totally to be funny.
Yeah.
She wasn't trying to be political
yeah.
or anything.
Yeah.
She was trying to be funny. Here's the other part I will say that I hold myself to a different standard than any of you hold yourselves to daily. I'm well aware that what I can say, what I'm saying, could be recorded. I've been in situations where you're at a bar and some guy's got his phone and he's aiming it at you, and you're telling a story about, I was telling a story about me and Ari and Joey Diaz, and this guy's recording it. And I was like, what the fuck? But he's got his phone down and he's just recording it. I'm also someone I don't like conversation, so I don't say anything. I just change the story into boring. But like, I'm well aware of what the effects, the tweets I have, I thought of a joke. I probably wouldn't even say it on this podcast, but I thought of a joke when we were at that fucking long ass chorus thing, the Christmas chorus.
The choir show.
Yeah, the choir show. I was gonna, I'll say it because I didn't tweet it, but I didn't tweet it because of that. But I was like, where are the school shootings when you want them?
Oh,
gosh.
Because I was like,
that's
yeah. I didn't tweet it, but I thought it. I thought it. I went, oh, that's, and because I was texting back and forth with my sisters.
Let me ask you something. So something like that. Could you, as a comedian, get away with saying that at a show and it would be all right?
Oh, 100%.
Okay, because there are comedians that are definitely
not. Oh, yeah. Oh, myself included. Like yeah. You can say the most aggressive things on stage, as long as your intent is right, or at least your persona.
You can read your intent when you're a live show, right?
Well, it's context.
But even you as a comedian, context, if you tweeted something like that, or something
I wouldn't tweet it. I wouldn't tweet it because I wouldn't tweet it not because I'm afraid of what would happen. I'm not afraid of what would happen. I wouldn't tweet it because I don't want to deal with it.
Right.
I don't want to spend a day replying and not replying to people.
Right.
Twitter for me has become cumbersome. Mm-hmm. If I want to get my voice out, I'll do it on my podcast or on my vlog. I'll say what I say. Because even what I just said, people could get upset at what I just said. But there's so much context in and around that everyone will go, well, no, he said he thought it. You can't now accuse people being horrible people for thoughts they have.
Right. But that's what they're going to do, though. They're going to take out that little statement and sensationalize that statement, and they're not going to hear about everything that it was in context.
Yeah, but it won't bother me. If it goes viral, it won't bother me because I'll sit there and go, no, you can't. And then if Matt Lauer sits me down and he says, so you said you approve of school shootings? I'll go, it's not what I said at all. And he's like, well, hold on. We have the clip. And then they play it and I go, that's not what I said. I was talking about a tweet I did not send. An inappropriate joke I thought of and didn't tweet because I know the microscope I'm under. Now, someone who wants to be a comedian, I don't know if anyone has ever had the taste of when you think of a really fucking funny thought. The taste of that is what Justine Sacco had. Ooh, I got a funny thought. I'm going to tweet it. And you don't, and Leanne see me do it. I don't reread it a couple times. I get so excited. I just type it in. And then you send it, you're like, come on, let's go. It's like a dopamine drip. And he talked about that a little bit, like a dopamine drip of watching someone fail and jumping on them. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was really fascinating because, I mean, I saw a guy on ESPN one time say, they said something about homosexuals, and he was like, well, nah, yeah, I don't believe in that, and I don't want it on my team. And I was on the treadmill, and I was like, he just said that on TV! What the fuck is wrong with this guy? And then I like started tweeting about him, but that guy didn't give a fuck. That's the other thing that's interesting.
Yeah, because the one guy in the book that kind of got away with it
didn't give a fuck.
Here, tell him who it was. Again. It was the Indy 5.
President of
Formula One in Britain.
Yes. And it was a sex scandal.
Yeah.
But his someone do it justice and tell the. Does anyone remember Sandy? You probably got this far, right? Do you remember this part? The Formula One racer.
One
the sex scandal.
I'm
going to
say no.
Nazi
twinges. Right. There were...
Well,
like,
just so it, just it to, like so a, that for someone listening, he ran Formula One in Britain. His dad was not a famous Nazi sympathizer. However, he knew a lot of big-time Nazis. His mom distinctly was a Nazi sympathizer. Hung out with Goebel and Himmler. But his dad had... connections definitely to Hitler, and I guess his brother and his sister disavowed his family.
I don't know, but he didn't.
And I think I might have done more research on the guy because I was fascinated by this. Turns out he goes to a dominatrix and they do some role play, but the role play is similar to Russian guard, like the Russian guard cleaning checklist system thing, and they're in Russian or not Nazi guard, and they're in Nazi outfit ish, like those colors.
German.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Comes out. Am I really all over the place?
No. That's a checklist. I don't know.
Anyway, it comes out, and he refused to accept the shame, and it went by him. That, and I don't know if you guys know who Bill Burr is. Does anyone? It's amazing how few people know who people are. Bill Burr is a very successful comedian, a friend of mine. I've known him for a long time, but right now, he's big. He's really big. He does Conan probably twice a month. He made a statement on Conan about Bruce Jenner, Caitlyn Jenner, and there was this backlash. And I saw Bill like the next day. I was like, I just said, you know, how are you doing with that? He just did with that guy. He goes, what backlash? What? What are you talking about? Who? Name them. Name the fucking people. And I was like, I was like, he was almost defiant, saying, "I don't fucking who's outraged? Where's the outrage? I don't see outrage." And he did what
that guy did is ignored the shame. Said, you can't shame me. I didn't say anything I don't believe in. I said it. What are you going to do? Almost like Donald Trump in a weird way. Mm-hmm. Like, yes, fuck it. Uh-huh. Yeah, I said it. What are you going to do?
But Donald Trump did lose like a $6 billion hotel deal in Dubai.
By saying he's not letting Muslims in?
Yeah, oh. Yesterday he lost it. So, that's good.
Yeah, well, that's because his hate is sort of expanding. First it was Mexicans, and now it's
I do not have a political, so I always veer away from politics, but he's saying a lot of what the Republicans have always kind of thought. He's just saying it out loud. Exactly. I mean, exactly. The Republicans are like, dude, keep that under the fucking carpet. We don't say we don't want them in.
Well, let's say a certain sect of the Republicans.
Yeah, yeah.
Not every Republican.
Like, everybody from where I'm from.
Yeah.
Everybody from Georgia is probably agreeing with Trump.
But do you
that
think
makes a lot of sense?
But do you think Justine Sacco, the comment she made of was a guy that did it?
That's what I was thinking. I think if a guy made it, he could have gotten away with it.
Right?
No.
I think there would have been a backlash. I still think that there would have been a public shaming. But I think a guy could have circumnavigated that better than a woman.
How a guy? Because guys can't get AIDS.
No, because
the same with the Formula One guy. If the Formula One president, if it was his daughter who got into that same
sex scandal,
I don't think.
Yeah, but think about those two guys that were in that.
Yeah, but
that conference,
was so wrong,
right?
To me, like,
but it was
they,
the women
yeah,
that
was,
shamed them.
Wait, let's take this one at a time. Let's take these one at a time. So wait, if it was a guy, in Justine Sacco's case, I think same outcome. The reason Justine Sacco was vulnerable is because she had something to lose. Her job was publicity, and she got fired from her job. I mean, it was like almost like the perfect storm. A publisher should know better than make an AIDS joke.
Right.
That is what burned her.
Yeah.
It's like a chef getting caught putting his dick in the mashed potatoes. You're like, dude, that's what we trust you for, is making mashed potatoes. How dare you put your dick? If a chef tweets it, you're like, I mean, he's a fucking chef. What do you expect from the guy?
But why did Paula Deen got, like, shoved?
Because
well,
she was saying the N-word. You can't just...
But what if it's a guy? What if it's, like, Bobby Flay said it?
Well, first of all, Bobby... Wait, hold on. I shouldn't talk much about Paula Deen because we're in the same family. But I think her contract's about to run out. She'd been so controversial. There's a lot of headaches. I think with a company, when you have an employee that's just a pain in the ass, like, she's making these horrible meals. She's diabetic. She's not telling anyone she's diabetic. She'd just done a bunch of shitty things. And then this comes out, and her contract, I think, was up for renegotiation. And they're like, we'd rather not give you this ridiculous amount of money that we've been giving you and just part ways. She'll be back, I think. I don't think America hates her. But I don't think guy or girl in Justine Sacco's case doesn't matter. The Formula One, had it been a woman, fucking done.
Yeah.
In that business, had it been a woman that had been caught in a sex scandal, because once a man sees you naked, your value has been compromised to society. That's like Erin Andrews gets, you know, they put a camera in, they show her naked, and men are like, it's almost like men then have an ability to try to devalue you, you know? Or a man, if you see him naked, I mean, like, Lenny Kravitz's dick pops out, and everyone's like, did you see it? Oh, I gotta get the new Lenny Kravitz album.
Right.
Yeah.
That's
true.
It is true. It does
devalue
a woman when she's naked.
Now, let's go back to the guy, and this is, now it flips it back to the same one. The guy who, am I running your book club? I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah, totally. But go ahead, finish this one, and then we'll take it back.
Okay. The guy who made the statement at the tech conference.
That to me was so wrong.
That was so wrong. The two guys made a bad comment between the two of them. That was so wrong. That's the stupidest thing, and that devalues feminism to me. That makes me mad as a feminist. I agree. Just for people who are listening, do you want to tell the story?
Two tech guys that were at a tech conference, right? And they were talking amongst themselves, and they made comments like with tech verbiage, like I want
a dongle. Something about a dongle. Yeah. I don't even know what it means.
And then the woman behind, who was clearly eavesdropping on their conversation, took offense because they were throwing these terms around to each other about something really innocuous, right?
Yeah.
But it had a vaguely sexual double entendre.
Yeah. It's something like in order to get into someone's hard drive, you frack it or something.
It was something
it's like
I'd
frack
like
your hard drive and then play with your dongle.
Right.
It was a joke. However, I'm just playing devil's advocate. Women in technology have a really hard time getting into
yes.
tech. So this is a minority in a group of guys, and then right behind her is a boys club.
She's also a minority, too.
And she's also a minority,
yes.
and she's also
she's
a
double minority. Yes, yes.
Yeah. And so she, what she did is she turned around, snapped a picture at the most inopportune moment, because the guy does do a creepy fucking face, like a,
Because he saw her taking the picture, so he was like,
hey, I'm a cool tech guy. That's uncomfortable.
Then she posted it, and before the conference was over, they removed him from there, saying something's been upset, and the next day he was fired. He then went out and publicly shamed her and said, I'm regretful for what I said. I did not ever mean to feel like that.
I have to feed three kids.
But I have to feed three kids, and this is super sucks. I loved my job. I had a great time at my job. Then, fucking wins
and everyone
change.
Turned on her.
Yeah.
And she got publicly shamed. It was all horrible.
She got the worst of it, I'd argue. Because she not only lost her job, now she's a snitch. Mm-hmm. No one wants to work with a snitch.
No.
Well, and also, it seems like the public shamings against women invariably go to, let's rape that bitch. They turn ugly, like, sexual violence, and that in a way that doesn't tend to happen to the men.
Right. The men are like, get fired.
Yeah.
They should be fired.
Yeah.
That's the worst.
Fire him.
Yeah.
That's true. I didn't really think about that, but that is true. It does go to that really deep.
It degrades women. Violently, whereas men are like, he should be fired.
Well, sexual domination is such a control.
Yeah.
It's about control.
That whole story made me so angry because I was so angry with her for doing that. But then when it turned on her, I was so angry about that. And that was the story that probably bothered me the most.
Yeah, that bothered me too.
I felt, and it sounds weird, but I felt like when it came back to her, not the rape stuff, but when she started to get shamed, I felt vindicated for men.
You know, I'll be honest, I kind of felt like she deserved it. I thought what she did was really shitty, and the fact that he did lose his job because of it. And then she even got, like, when he did that, and she got pissed off that he did that to her. And I'm like, but you did the exact same thing to him. You know what
and,
I
like,
mean?
A year later, or whatever it was, when she was interviewed, she was like, I'm glad he lost his job.
Yeah, like, she had no...
No.
Yeah,
it's no culpability at all.
None whatsoever.
Yeah. But I think if you think about it, like, she said that she did that because she was scared. She wasn't scared. She just wanted to do that. She just was like, oh, fuck, it's
so
not
now she's using sex as a control.
Well, no, so she used that as an opportunity to publicly shame these people. There's no reason for her to have done that. None other than, hey, I can get some time.
Right.
And then so she, I mean.
Because if it really bothered her and she was mature, wouldn't you go and confront them and say, hey, I think you're.
Or you would go to someone physically there and go,
there's
a problem.
Yes. Yeah. No, exactly. Yeah. You don't.
Yeah, they want to stick their dongles into hard drives, and I find it disgusting.
And I'm leaving.
Disgusting.
So that's what I think is, if I'm uncomfortable, I leave the situation, right?
Yeah.
Because if I'm the only one that feels in danger or whatever, then you take care of yourself. That's the thing, too, I found fascinating was how we're supposed to take care of everybody else. Right, I can't say this to take care of you. I can't say this to take care of you. But why don't you just take care of yourself? You know, when you hear something that's offensive, just don't listen to it. You know, just turn it off.
Turn it off.
Because the loudest voices rise to the top, right? So if the loudest voice you hear is "you're bad" and "you're terrible," I just want to turn it off. I don't want to hear that. So if everybody would just turn it off, they'd stop doing it. It's like the you know,
or they get louder because no one's saying anything. I'll take my life experience, and you know, I mean, growing up in the South, every hateful word you could ever imagine was uttered just in a baseball practice.
Yes.
Like, that's what the coaches would call you. That's what you were like. Those are all the bad words were ever said. Like the word faggot, I was part of my vernacular up until I moved to New York. When I moved to New York, I was like, oh, you can't just say that. That means something. But, like, I would never have learned had I not... I would just still be dropping F-bombs everywhere. The term gay, to call something gay. I didn't learn that. You couldn't say, oh, that shirt's gay. Because that affects a child who may be dealing with their sexuality. I would never want... God forbid any of your kids would be gay. And I say gay to your husband about his car or his shirt. And then that your kid goes, well, fuck. I'm having sexual questions. And Bert, I like Bert. He's cool. You think that's bad? to be gay. Like, I would never want that, but I learned that from Todd Glass like 3 years ago. Like, 3 years ago. So, it is good for people to speak up.
Well, yeah, but and it is good to have, you know, to be aware of other people. You don't just go around and...
There's a way to do it, is what I think you're saying.
Yeah, you don't... Yeah, I mean, everybody knows what's appropriate and what's not appropriate for
they
most
don't.
Part.
Not
for the most part.
Everybody knows.
Well, but I think the issue is, like, everyone sensationalizes things as well. And they want to be that one that puts that out there and gets that out there and gets, oh, you remember that? Like, they have to feel more important than they really are.
It's a very narcissistic time.
That's the buzzword.
Yeah.
Narcissism.
I think you're so right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is very sad.
Because do you edit your jokes because of
Yeah,
this?
Of course.
You do?
Yeah, there's jokes I won't tell because, like, I have a joke. I was actually thinking about this yesterday. I have a joke with the M-word in it. The M-word's a punchline. It's the funniest goddamn story that's ever happened to me. One of the funniest, one of those beautiful moments in life where the M-word just happens to be the punchline. And it, a black guy says it, and it's perfect. It's totally innocuous, and it's even funnier than a black guy says it. Because he says it, I mean, this is the joke in short, but when I was a kid, I was in traffic. I was in a going to drop off my keys to my boss, and there was a big party at this apartment complex. I was in Annie's convertible Mustang, blue Mustang. And I pull up and I was like, fuck, I thought I'd know someone because I've been in college so long. I didn't know anyone at this party. And I was like, that's odd that I don't know anyone at this party. Like, I kept looking around going, like, I should know a couple people. So I pull around the corner. I was like, fuck it, I'll just drop them off in the morning. Pull around the corner. There's an equally big party in on the other side that's all black because Tallahassee was split. It was FAMU and Florida State.
Did you know anybody there?
No, I did not. But what was interesting is my energy changed because as opposed to in the white party, I was looking at everyone and like trying to find someone I knew. I go to the black side, the black party, and I'm literally face forward, not making eye contact with anyone. Now, mind you, this is back during the OJ Rodney King riots. So there is a tension, and it's Tallahassee is a segregated city. And I'm going to ruin the joke because I won't say the M word just because I don't say it. Oh, I'm not going to say it. I'll fucking tape and put it out there forever. Right now, I haven't even decided to say it. So anyway, so I'm in a convertible. The top's down. And this black guy just gets, I'm in the middle of this party. I'm not moving at all. And this smaller black dude just comes up to my door and is like, are you scared? And I'm like, I didn't answer him. I was like, I didn't hear that. And he's like, I said, are you scared, white boy? And I'm just sitting there going, I'm about to get punched. And he's like, look at me when I talk to you. And so I kind of look at him and he goes, and he's smiling. And he goes, are you scared? And I went, no. And he goes, well, tell me if you're scared now. And in the perfect white guy voice, he goes, move it, you. And drops the N-word and shouts it. And literally 100 black people turn and look at me and they're like, what the fuck did you just say? And I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, no, it was him. And the guy's now walked away from the car. He's like, what the fuck did you say? And I'm like, dude. And he starts laughing and his friends start laughing. And he comes out and he goes, I said it. And I was like, holy shit. And then he just comes up to my car and he starts talking to me. And I'm like, that's the funniest thing anyone's ever fucking done. And I would love to be able to tell that on stage and work it out as a bit. And because I didn't say it, I want to say the word. But I don't want to say the word because I'm editing myself. Right. I definitely edit myself. There's times where I go on stage and I just talk and I don't edit myself. But a lot of what I put out on social media, I've edited this podcast before. Definitely I've edited this podcast where I say something and I'm like, ah, that came out wrong.
Was it before this book you read? Or
No. This book came out of perfect storm because I'm obsessed with public shaming. We had a friend who, I don't want to even get into it because I don't want to feed the beast. I don't want to fucking restoke the flames. But I had a good friend who had, got caught in a lie and,
kind of like the Bob Dylan story. Kind of like that. Uh-huh. Is a lot. But his was actually much more significant than the Bob Dylan.
Massively significant. And I talked to him. I was at Fox when it broke. And he was through. We worked with them. And I talked to him literally probably like a few hours after it broke. And he was just devastated. And mind you, I had gone to pitch a sitcom at Fox. Thinking about my livelihood. How can I make more money? And then all of a sudden, it just weighed on me the fragility of public opinion. You know, like literally, no, this was pretty intense. I mean, this guy's thing was pretty intense.
Yeah.
But that night when I gave Georgia a kiss goodnight, I thought, he's got two kids. Oh, fuck. His kiss goodnight to his kids must be scary.
But he, I mean, never mind.
Well, I'm not going to defend more.
We'll talk about it after this.
Yeah, we'll talk about it after.
Recording is over. I have some strong opinions.
I mean, everybody should read this book because it does make you think twice about public shaming somebody. But then also, there, like, say a situation like that, or the guy who was, you know, with the Bob Dylan article. I mean, that guy had been lying on other stuff too.
Yeah.
Eventually,
yeah.
He's got to get called out. Yeah. He can't keep doing it. Eventually,
yeah.
He's got to get called out.
Those guys never get fucking caught, though.
I know. Well, so that's
yeah.
Right.
The sociopaths dodge all the fucking bullets.
Yeah, yeah.
They're fucking impervious to criticism or to self-awareness of like, oh, I'm fucking...
No, it is a lack of the ability to take responsibility for themselves. They will not hold themselves accountable, I think. There's
think
no accountability. So even if they lie...
Do you think they really don't see... Do you think in their minds they really don't see that they did something wrong?
They convince themselves they did something right.
They do.
Acting.
I believe that.
Yeah, that they are so maybe so sociopathic, or they have they really, I think, convince themselves that
they
they're
do.
In their...
I've had a few friends like that. I've seen them be drawn to those
people. I have one parent like that. One parent who would tell a lie that I watched the truth happen and then tell a lie, and she completely believed that lie. Absolutely. And would look at me and go, you're lying. And I'd go, but wait a minute. I just witnessed what just happened. Nope, you're lying. This is what happened.
Is it me?
Totally changed.
No.
Are you my parent?
Are
you
my father? Parent.
I thought you said a parent.
Wow, if English is that bad, this book must have been kicking your ass.
She said the parents.
No,
parents.
Her parents.
Oh,
your
parents.
Oh,
I heard
the same thing.
Right?
I she did. Said a parent.
Yes. Yeah,
I have
Thank
a
you,
parent.
She's the lawyer.
No,
she's defending.
I
heard a parent.
A means singular of two. I had a parent. Singular.
You had a parent? I just thought, maybe
a parent at school.
No,
that's
my
mother.
Yeah.
Maybe that could have been fair if you said my mom.
I didn't really want to say my mother, but anyway,
it was clear
my
for
mother.
The rest of us.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm thinking. Those of you who listen when I talk to you,
no,
about
no,
you
no,
mother,
for all of us who don't have guilty consciences,
is this couch right here? We all hurt. A parent.
Yeah.
We're just trying to find out what parent it was.
No, do you know why I heard that? Because in my mind, I was thinking of things that I don't want to talk about right now, but public shamings that have occurred within our social sphere.
Who?
Yeah.
At school. Things.
At school?
Yeah.
There's hardcore. This is a microcosm of public shaming.
Yeah.
I love it when the shaming starts and someone comes up to you and they're like, guess who? ... I've been telling a joke about it on stage about Steven coming up going, I want to show you a little something. it's almost because, and that's fascinating because
is that shaming
or is that just gossip?
It's gossip, but it's shaming. Imagine.
But there's plenty of shaming that goes on. I mean,
but I'm talking about.
But how is gossip shaming?
No, I think what he's talking about is gossip. I'm talking about the different story that is much more, I think, shaming. And, there's a very divided camp about certain things that have occurred.
At our school.
Okay,
yes.
I'm completely out of this loop. I don't know what you're talking about.
Hold on. Ready. Hang on one second.
If you don't understand, how do you think I would understand?
Yeah.
I was going to put it on pause so we could all get on the
same
page.
You're a parent, too?
That would be shame. Yes, I agree.
Yeah, right?
That's
wait, what?
Very
wait,
clear.
But
I
did
we
pause?
No, we have not paused it.
Yeah, do not.
Pause that shit, brother.
This is the first of two edits where I have to take out a name. I'm sorry. Hey, Sandy, they can definitely hear that.
Okay,
now I'm
going
to have to fucking edit that out.
I'm not even speaking.
It's all Sandy.
God damn it. 37:37 is 38 minutes. That's where I got to edit out Sandy whispering like she's
Kathy,
in a helicopter.
That's Kathy.
Kathy.
That's Kathy. No, it was Sandy who said it.
Yeah.
It was Colleen. Colleen said it.
Well, how about this? How about this? There's, I don't know if, is it shaming for when someone veers from the norm behavior you're allowed to do at that school? Is it shaming or is it just gossip and we punish them with gossip and they know we're gossiping?
Well, isn't that the same if you're punished with gossip as opposed to just being gossiped about and it doesn't, not that there's not harmful gossip, but... But there is gossip taken to a level where that person knows it's happening. And that person knows it's widespread.
And that's plus shaming. That's
exactly.
Shaming.
But I feel
right.
Like in that situation, I don't think that person cares, do they?
No.
I don't even feel like it's gossip.
I feel like people are mean about it.
Are
yeah.
They?
And
I
people are
so
very
too.
Divided.
I think
and
punitive.
Very,
yeah.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Punitive is
well,
the word.
It's,
yeah.
Well,
absolutely.
It's people who don't got it because I don't. I don't know who that person is. But I don't give a fuck what they decide to do in their personal life. In a weird way, like, I'm super in love with my wife, and I can't, when we do drop off, there's only like four or five women that I'd sleep with before my wife. Like I'm saying,
and you're all in this room, by the way. Who's the odd man out? Like, yeah. One, two, three, four, it's all of you. Like,
oh, bullshit. I can Lance name top. I can name Lance top five right now. Number one. Number one. Okay, be dead honest with you. None of you find
take out name
attractive.
No, he's too
weird. I mean,
we'll talk about this.
Guys.
Pause.
What's the number? No. What's the number?
3956.
3956. All right. Just go back to the book. Okay, yeah, the next question.
Maybe we should have a Monday morning assembly shame.
We are going.
That would be great.
Just bring the geese to that.
Hold on. That's an interesting. Once a month. That's interesting. Oh, my God. What if you did Monday morning assembly and you shamed everyone? You're like, all right, everybody. I know we've all been gossiping about this person. Gossip to stop Tuesday. We're going to put them and we're going to spray paint their chest with a big L for lose or whatever. And then
the principal read the list. Of
instead
done.
Of coffee and conversation, just like coffee and shaming.
It's like the police blog.
Yeah, I like that idea.
Right? Instead of like, you know, talk about things that are just not really...
Right, that's
interesting.
The holiday boutique.
The holiday boutique.
Whatever.
Right. You know, field trips.
So what are the questions you have on there, Kirsten?
Oh, we're back to
what
this.
Do we got?
We're back to this.
I think we need to be back to this.
Well, yeah, this is, can you come up with your own examples of someone who received a highly public shaming through social media?
I'm about to shame you for being such a nerd. Did you really put up a fucking... Jesus Christ.
I refuse to be shamed. It's what I do. It's,
she goes prepared so she cannot be shamed.
Right. No, do you know what? I was a late add to this book club, so I felt like I had to step up. Like, I felt like I had to come prepared.
She's showing off.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you,
showing her butt.
She's the overachiever in her group.
Yeah.
Oh.
The only one.
Says the overachiever.
The only one, right?
Yeah, oh, do not remind me. Note to self, do not come to Lynn's book club. Those are shit. Oh, fuck. I'll shame myself. So,
are we done?
Honestly, did you don't remember?
Hey, I didn't read the end of the book. How does it end? Like, I realized halfway through that I need glasses.
So I'm not the only one who didn't finish.
You know
what?
I wanted to shame you first so that I could come out and say that I did the same thing.
Thanks, Bert.
I have to say, I wish I had the book. The last page of the book
might be in my bag.
Summed up the whole book in like one or two sentences.
Yeah.
And I left that book disappointed.
I feel like during it my
because
first.
I wanted him, it was such a kind of a...
He went back, didn't he? And he met up with a couple other people.
He did.
Yeah,
I left the book feeling like I wanted to know more about the psychology of this.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
One
it would be,
level
yeah.
deeper instead of the journalistic reporting of it. I felt like it was very well done journalistically, but I wanted to go one layer deeper.
I felt like there were no answers.
I feel like there was a last
sentence, and I swiped the page, and I was like, "Wait, what do you mean it's done? Like it hasn't. It's not over.
Right.
Like you haven't."
I felt
like I actually went back thinking I missed a page somehow.
Uh-huh.
And it was just a Vanity Fair article.
Yeah.
Yes. I felt exactly. That, yes.
I totally agree. Instead of just a book, I'm just like, that's why.
And he had no opinion on anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It was just report.
Yeah.
Which was, that's one way to do it. That's fine. But I wanted more meat.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I wanted more meat. It didn't pull me enough.
It was just shy of a Malcolm Gladwell book. Like it was.
You know, that's not a bad way of putting it.
Yeah.
I mean, very Malcolm.
No, I was just saying that when
he was
very
Malcolm Gladwell-esque. But when I close Malcolm Gladwell's book, I feel like I have really learned something about something, and I didn't feel like I'd really learned anything more than I felt like what I already knew was more exposed.
It's almost like he set us up to start hating people. Like he was like, you either go, you read that book and you're like, oh fuck that shit, or you're like, oh that guy's cool.
Or
like
I'm
got
never
a
going
couple
on
people.
Social media ever.
What?
Yes. Or I'm never going on social media ever because everyone on it is evil.
Do you know what I loved what he said, which is something that I don't know. I think we probably all struggle with this to some extent or another about what you post on Facebook or Instagram or you know whatever you're putting out there, even if you just have a little thumbprint online. He talked about how it's sort of
is this just encouraging us to become more vanilla? Because the one girl who they rehabilitated her image by pushing the bad bad stuff down to
2 pages.
It was like with her cat videos, like, you know, all the bland vanilla boring stuff. She had to do all this boring stuff to get that pushed up. And I thought that was a really good point, because a lot of the time there are, I mean, I'm the furthest thing from a comedian. I'm not funny, but occasionally, you know, you have a picture of your kids you want to post on Facebook and it's a funny little caption and, you know, that rush of like wanting to get the joke out there or whatever. And then I think, oh, are people really going to even get that? And am I suddenly the person who makes the comment and just backing off from things that might be like in your instinct and that the people who know and love you would get, but that maybe you don't want out there for the greater consumption.
But I wouldn't say that you're turning more vanilla. You're taking a medium that really never existed and saying I'm choosing not to use it. That's all. It's like, say hypothetically, roller skates. It's like when roller skates showed up, I bet there are a lot of people that are like, man, this is putting a lot of flair into dropping off orders at a drive-in. This is pretty fucking cool. Then a few broken arms, and everyone's like, so you're not using roller skates. Like, you chose not to use roller skates? You're getting boring. Like, you used to be skating and give them a thing. You're like, yeah, but I got fucked up a couple times, and now I don't want to use roller skates anymore. And so it's like, social media is like roller skates. You see this in person, I saw a guy with roller skating through West Hollywood the other day, and I thought, hard, and I was like, oh man, I miss my roller skates. There's one day that you'll just go, oh, this is, maybe I'll tweet this. Like, it's, I very seldomly use Twitter. I turn on all the filters. I don't read the app mentions very much. I only go verified, so that like if someone says something shitty about me, but that means something to people listening.
No, I have no idea what you're talking about.
If I go and read my mentions, it's all the stuff I've done this week. People commenting, so just catching up. Rogan's podcast, Josh Wolf's podcast, The Ice House Show. And so I'm subject to scrutiny. Like, people are allowed to say, hey man, no offense, but your stand-up show has turned into just one fucking drunken event. I don't get that you're doing stand-up anymore. And then that really hurts my feelings. And then I go, I'm telling really great jokes. I tell a 12-minute story. Name one comic telling a 12-minute fucking story shirtless on stage that fucking kills, that has a beginning, middle, and end, and fucking pathos and ethos. Go fuck yourself. But I am shirtless and I am drinking, so it does. You guys all so much saw my show. It looks like I'm just throwing a party, and I just happen to talk about my wife farting and my kids being weird, and then robbing a train. And if, to the untrained eye, it may look like a guy who doesn't know what he's doing, but I know what I'm doing, and I'm presenting it a certain way. I mean... I don't know how we get on this rant.
I don't know.
Anyway,
roller skates.
But you're not turning vanilla. You're just simply choosing not to
not put it out there.
Yeah, but it's like, but you never had it. Like, when
you're choosing to keep your toppings to yourself.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Yeah. You're enjoying life. Let me tell you something. Leanne knows I've been doing this with my vlog. I had so much fun. I was putting so much shit out there. I was putting content. We celebrated the morning noon together. Our whole family put all our worries on a list and then buried it in a hole by the ocean. And then the water came and washed them away on the fucking fullest moon of the year. It was a beautiful moment. I put it all fucking line. I put it online for people to scrutinize. And then I started getting self-conscious. And then I woke up one morning and I was like, what the fuck am I doing? Like, last night we went to dinner with our friends and I brought my camera because I know my friends are famous. And I know that if I use them in my vlog, they'll get hits. And she's pregnant. It's not, you're not becoming vanilla, you're just choosing to be more private, which is, I think, noble these days. I don't think
Well, the flip side of that, the thing that concerns me about that is what artists and creative people are suppressing themselves for the same reason.
Yes.
Because they're afraid to go outside the box to express who they really are. Like, our daughter, our youngest daughter, is not an inside-the-box kid in any way. And there's so much that I keep trying, like, for instance, this is a very innocuous example. They all had to write a story about the artifact. Do you remember that? They found the abalone hook. So I'm looking on the wall, and it's like, the dig, I found a fossil, the expedition, all these things that are really, you can really draw straight back to, I found an artifact. Isla's is called The Thing I Always Wanted. And her story is about the thing I always wanted. I always wanted this thing. And she found it, and that was the thing. And she didn't even know that's what she wanted. But when she found it, that was it. And I thought, what a different way of looking at what the assignment was.
So as an adult, when you get to a place where your world is broader, your brain is broader, you have more inappropriateness available to you, how does that suppress somebody? Then you don't become Banksy or whatever the guy's name is who's breaking the law by spray painting on shit. You know, how does that affect this generation in that arena? You know, we complain all the time in book club that we can't find books that are deep enough or rich enough or we're bored or it's hard to finish, because where's the artist that's living the life that's free enough to put something down on paper that is not afraid will offend somebody?
Well, it's called Life at the Party. It's available at Bert. Go get my book.
Or Audible.com.
How about at
Audible.com/Bertcast.
You need to do a read at the beginning of this before we start. Yeah, guys, go to, I don't know if we mentioned, I'm sure we did, but we'll put another plug for Audible.com. We love Audible. They have my book, Life of the Party, there. You can get this book, John Ronson's book, Life of the Party, whatever it's called.
So
you've been publicly shamed. Now, are we publicly shaming, and then is that going to put our kids into boxes? Because they'll learn really quick, like, just how quick their outreach is. Georgia doesn't even realize when she's liking my Instagram pictures at 9:30, and I'm like, honey, you're supposed to be asleep. And all of a sudden my phone dings, Georgia Kreischer liked this picture. I'm like she's oblivious to the internet. Are we putting our kids in a box where they're going to go?
But can I just say one thing?
Yeah.
I don't even belong on Facebook because of, like you say, enjoying life. I don't like to be having people comment on my life.
It's nobody's right. business.
It's nobody's business. And I don't even do that. And I get in trouble for saying something to someone because I asked if she was pregnant or not. And then
she
publicly shamed me in front of you.
Yeah.
In front of you.
In front of me.
She said that I, you know, do I think she has cancer? Because I asked her, I was like, is it true that you're, I didn't say, is it true you're pregnant? I said, is it true? Like, she said, I looked at her like she's, like, she has cancer. But, and I don't even belong on Facebook.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's,
and then, right,
her
she added
problem.
You on Facebook.
That's
but that's what but the, that, but, the yeah. society is. Right. Everybody has their problem.
Right. No, exactly.
Everyone.
Yes.
Like, and everyone has their comments. Yeah. And blah, 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 blah.
Those people are broken. Anyone who fucking
exactly.
confronts you like that, those people are broken. People say shit inappropriate to me all the fucking time. And I just let it slide off my shoulder. I go, okay, sure thing. That's what you think about me. It's like, what was the dad that came up to me one time? And he's like, oh, it's good to know I'm not the fattest guy at pick up today. Don't say his name. Remember that guy said that? And I was like, okay. And a lot of people were like, man, you've been getting big on the road. And I'm like,
I say that to you every drop off.
Well, yeah.
Thanks for the public shaming.
I got really fucking upset. I got upset that day that lady did that. I was like, how dare you pull someone aside and go, I need to talk to you. You hurt my feelings. What the fuck?
And
you're supposed to talk behind someone's back.
And put it on Facebook.
I was going to say,
yeah.
she,
like, she took it a step further.
Yes.
Like,
yeah.
that
but
was,
she throws
right.
her life on Facebook.
Yeah.
So I
those, oh, those
I
people are those
dead.
People are broken.
So then you're asking for scrutiny.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're
yeah.
asking
yeah.
for
it. You put pictures of your kids on there literally all day long. From the if I see one more picture of her kids on there, I'm going to, like, scream. I mean, like,
yeah.
it's enough already.
And
I
if you unfriend her, heaven forbid, she atom bomb on your address. Boom. Right? You can't unfriend her.
Maybe I should send her that book.
Yeah.
Just leave it on her porch.
Put it on a link on her page. She'll see it.
She seems to have plenty of time to read.
I don't even
she's
know the woman's name.
She's always posting articles on her too all the time. Like, what time do you read all this crap? But, like, every day there's a new article on there about
something. If you look at people's Facebook, it's some people, it is their life.
Yeah.
Like you'll have people that'll be on your Facebook that are like, hey, man, how come you didn't accept my friend request? And you're like, because I'm 43. Like, I don't know, man. I know you. If I'm in your town, I'll just call you. Like, what do you mean? Accept your... Well... I noticed you know, I sent you a message. How come you didn't send my face request? And you're like, because I can only have 5,000 people. What do you mean? Oh, you're a public figure. You can only have 5,000 people. Follow my fan page. I don't fucking know. But there are people whose lives, that is the, I'm in therapy talking about this right now. I'm addicted to something my therapist just calls scrolling. Or I named it, but it's just scrolling. And it's like, you ever get on Facebook and you start scrolling and scrolling and scrolling and scrolling. And then all of a sudden you're like a month away from the original date you're looking. And you're like, oh shit, Ryan Carson got in a scuba diving accident? And then you email him. He's like, I've been out of the hospital for 8 weeks. And you're like, fuck. Like, but it's like almost like scrolling and looking for a dopamine drip. It's one of the things with drinking with me was when we first met is I, it would be scrolling. I'd just be drinking, waiting for it to be epic, something big to show up so it would fucking fulfill me. And then last night, just a couple glasses of wine, and I'm totally fine. You know, it's like I've totally kicked it. So,
it's a book club, not there.
Yeah, book club.
Anybody else's conclusion about the book? Anybody? What's everybody else's? I voiced my opinion about the book. How about everybody else? How did you feel about
the book? Go around the room, Kathy.
No, I think I said it already. I was like, what do you mean it's over? Like, there's not, there needs to be more substance to it. Like, it was interesting, but it didn't answer anything. I wanted some sort of resolution about this, and there was none.
Maybe that was the point.
Yeah, I don't think that was
maybe we're in the middle of it, and it was,
right, there probably is no answer, but
that's why I didn't finish the book.
Ooh, can I, real quick, real quick.
My conclusion is, I have no conclusion.
Real quick, did anyone go online and watch the video of John Ronson of approaching the guys who came up with his fake meme? His fake thing?
No.
I did. It's pretty fucking good. Well, yeah, those guys are smarmy as shit. Like, they're just like, they're like, so John, you assume that you are the John Ronson. Like, it's real. Like, you can see he's like, oh, I got to deal with these fucking idiots. Mm-hmm. I like their Twitter feed. I liked those jokes. I thought they were pretty, I thought they were enjoyable. It's better than his real one. John, if you're listening to this, I mean, step up your Twitter game, son.
But you're not even on Twitter. You just said.
I'm on it. I look at it, but I don't like, I'll read other people's tweets. Like, I went on a tear the other day reading everything The Rock had put out. But like, John Ronson, if you want to come on the podcast, you're more than welcome to. You can sit and you can hold yourself to task with all these ladies. Colleen, what did you think about the book?
I liked it. I did. But I agree. I think everybody should read it in that it makes you aware of what's happening out there and how detrimental it can be to somebody's life.
It's like a Malcolm Gladwell book, but without any of the fun racism and great stats.
Yeah.
It's like if Malcolm Gladwell is if reading Malcolm Gladwell's like great kitchen sex, then this book was like protected sex in a hospital bed.
In a hospital bed.
Well, yeah, it's kind of hot, but you're like, this is where I'm gonna
How about
get something.
In a sleep number bed.
In a sleep number bed. It was still a good book. I still liked it, but Lynn, you're the lawyer.
I just thought it was okay. It was just stories, but like everyone said, no resolution, no, you know, what happened to the girl now that her reputation is rehabilitated, but what happened since this book came out? Because now everyone knows,
right,
did
now
she go,
back
did
right.
it?
By the way, right. She's back up on the top of the fucking trending list. You can't, the girl with the thing, with the flicked off the thing?
Yeah.
Just real quick, there was a girl that, she said her gig was that she saw the picture, then she'd do whatever is the opposite of the picture, which is kind of a hacky thing to do. A lot of people have done it, except for the one at Arlington Cemetery, where it said, please be quiet and be respectful, and she pretended to scream and flicked off the camera, and then that went viral. Everyone shit on her. And by the way,
she lost her job. Mm-hmm. Her dream job.
She lost her job working with special needs kids.
Special needs kids and doing an excellent job.
Fucking fire the guy that fired her. What asshole goes,
seriously.
Hey guys, no offense. I mean, like, I don't hope to sound callous, but no one she's working with is fucking on the internet like that. Like, she's working with special needs people, who adults too, I think, at that, who need that is bullshit.
A certain type of person. And she was blowing off steam, and yes, it was inappropriate. Yes, it was.
But that
wrong.
Was the whole point.
I thought
of that
it was
funny.
That it was
I
laughed at it.
That's the person I'm talking about. Yeah. That someday is an artist.
Yes.
Some kid that does that as a teenager, and they're
no, because even despite the fact, of course, it was hacky. But sometimes, you know, maybe she's blowing off steam with these hacky jokes, and she's got, you know, she's obviously got stuff going on. She's, you know, counterculture, counterintuitive.
Yeah, exactly.
I used to do these things called "What Will the Maid Think," where I'd leave the room in an interesting way. You might have seen them.
Yeah.
You probably haven't seen them. But I thought they were fun. They were lighthearted. And then I got fucking, not publicly shamed, but I got a few death threats. And I was like,
from who?
What are you?
Wait, is that where you did the things?
Do you think I kept these death threats to myself, Leanne? I told you about these.
I don't remember any death threats.
Well, yeah, it's like,
oh, Leanne, we contacted.
You exaggerate everybody, everything.
Oh, my God.
You contacted who?
Guys, if you could, my wife's Twitter is Leanne's Pussy. At Leanne's Pussy.
You do not have a Twitter.
Your Twitter is
Leanne's
Pussy.
You did not set up a Twitter that's Leanne's Pussy.
I set up a Twitter that's Leanne's Pussy. So go and publicly shame her for not listening to her over-exaggerating husband. It's at Leanne's Pussy. It's a picture of you.
Why did you do that?
because I wanted to publicly shame you. Because I thought it was funny.
I don't think that's funny.
Well, you don't use it. So what do you fucking care? It's not real.
But it's in the world.
I saw it.
You did?
Leanne, hold on. Listen to this. This is a woman that was just talking about out of the box and social media. You don't use Twitter. It does not exist to you because you don't use Twitter. It's out there. Does it change your life that there is a... Hold on. Think about... Does it change your life that there is a Twitter account called Leanne's Pussy?
Okay, let's ask this. Sandy?
Yes.
Would you like someone to have set up a Twitter for you called Sandy's Pussy?
Yeah.
You guys heard it here. Someone set up Sandy's Pussy.
All right, Tom.
Because Sandy's not my name. You know? So I don't care. There's a lot of Sandy out there.
So would any of you like that?
Should we do
it?
I don't like that.
It doesn't matter because it's not real.
But
to
it
you.
Matters to me, so that's all that matters.
But who's okay, putting on that?
Yeah, but first of all, just
who's going on responding is me. You?
Nobody knows that. I mean, we don't know you have a Leanne's Pussy site.
But now you do. But wait, it's so interesting because you don't use Twitter.
It's like the whole beginning of the John Ronson thing, though. This is exactly.
Thank you.
This is why he got so upset.
He got so upset because
you did what those hackers did to me.
Right, exactly. True.
No, but the point is.
And they had to stop. You have to take down Leanne's pussy.
Yes. Yeah. Take her down. Go to the back room.
I took down Leanne's pussy.
You guys have some privacy.
Shut her down.
Book club's over.
Let's see if I can
take
find
down
it.
Her pussy.
Is it for real?
He's not.
You got 23 followers. But it's not real. Like that's what that.
Yeah, but you do. You're right. You're doing the same thing to me that those guys did to me.
Oh my god.
Yeah, but at the same time, like
no, let me see that.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yeah. But it doesn't matter to you because you don't use Twitter. Like that's like me saying, hey, just so you know, I put up a billboard in Saudi Arabia saying Leanne has gained some weight, and you go, take it down, but you'll never see it. No, those people.
The whole beginning of the book was the exact same thing.
Yeah, but
so you right? are sociopathic.
Okay. So right? the followers
are
Tom
like...
Haislip, Stephen Frompton.
Are you kidding?
Jeff Bernard, Richard Love.
I guarantee you.
Eric Grusin.
I grabbed it because I mentioned it on a podcast.
Oh,
I mentioned it on a podcast, and I was like, I didn't want someone else to grab Leanne's pussy.
Joe Rogan.
Nuh-uh.
Yeah.
The comedy store.
Yeah, Joe Rogan follows. Oh, the comedy
store. That is a picture of me.
Yeah.
You
look good in the picture. I thought you'd like that.
Yeah, but I don't want that.
All right, I'll take it down.
Does everybody in her think it's wrong?
Yes.
Well, especially if her picture's on there.
Yeah, but she's in costume.
Then you don't matter. Hold on.
Not a picture of that.
Wait a minute. Don't you think there are some savvy parents at our school who, let's see if Leanne is on Twitter. Oh, she is. It's called Leanne's Pussy.
No, there's no savvy parent. There's no savvy parent at our school.
I found that site.
There is not one parent. You're lying, Sandy. There's not one parent more savvy at our school about social media than myself.
Okay, I didn't say there was someone who was more.
No.
I said there are parents who are.
Okay,
let's see if we can find...
Take
that off.
Okay.
There are people who look for stuff like that.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like, that's the difference.
Oh, you know
Leanne
what?
Kreischer.
Very popular. Saw it.
You're blemishing my footprint.
So, right? Hold on. Now, let's see this. This is Leanne Kreischer. You have a Twitter account.
How do I have that?
Leanne, you can't fucking stop this. This has already happened. But it's pointless. It's like a billboard in Saudi Arabia.
No, it's not. It's exactly like the beginning of this book. And yes. I would like for you to please take down.
We
the
don't
answers.
Know anyone in
Saudi Arabia.
I will
definitely take
Arabia,
it down right after I post
Twitter.
This podcast.
Right.
Yeah, especially since you're public. People might research.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what will happen when I take it down.
Okay. Do you follow her on Twitter?
No.
You don't follow me?
Because she's following himself.
No, I created the fucking account. It's my email address.
Okay.
Yeah, so I created
I'm
the account.
I'm not on Twitter, so.
Because
I'm
I made.
I'm not either.
Twitter works.
So, okay.
But I am, twice. And I'm not even on it.
Because if it was, then people are going to look at him, see who he follows, it follows them, and they'll see Leanne's pussy, and they all know that Leanne's his wife.
That's true.
Hold on. Listen, by the way, I am talking to a group. I'm Columbus, and we're going to explore the world, and you guys are on the boat going, so wait, if it is flat, do we fall off?
No.
Guys, I live in this space. I know more about this. I will delete it. What will happen is someone listening to this right now will then recreate it. He'll simply go, well, Leanne's pussy is available. I'll make that. And then he'll be in control of it. That's the reason I grabbed it, is because I mentioned it on a podcast. I'm going to get the website.
Well, let's take my picture off of it at least.
Okay, we'll put my picture on. Perfect. And then
that would be awesome.
And then I'll take your picture off. And then,
because that would actually make sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
Your picture.
Totally. Yeah.
Well, but it does make sense.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And then,
that makes sense to me that someone else will grab it.
Someone will grab it, and then they will be in control of it. I mentioned it on a podcast. Yeah, my wife's got her Twitter. Oh, shut up, what's Twitter? Oh, it's Leanne's pussy. And everyone started laughing. And then as soon as I said it, I went, I need to grab that before someone grabs it. And then starts tweeting. And everyone goes, oh, that's Bert's wife. So I grabbed it. And your only, I think the only tweet that I've put up is, by the way, I think a lot of people are going to like this podcast. And I think you guys are going to have to start doing this more often. Book club. The Ant.
It's more interesting than the last book club. I mean, no.
What was the last book club?
I don't remember.
We were at Harvest Moon, right? What was the book?
Yeah, we were at Harvest Moon, and it was...
Oh, it was the book that everyone liked except for me.
Yes.
What was the last book club?
The book about the Nightingale.
By the way,
Nightingale, right.
Everyone thinks it's Leanne Tweeden's pussy. The tweet was, ha ha, beat you guys to the punch. So I grabbed it so that no one could grab it. And I'll take your face off it, and I'll put
eyelids.
That's fair.
No! All right, we haven't gotten around the room. Lynn, what did you think? What did you think about the book? You thought it was like prison sex? What did you say?
I don't recall saying that. It was just fine.
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of boring. It didn't...
Just like prison sex. Just like
boring. Exactly. It's fine. You know, gets the job done.
What are you laughing at?
I don't recall saying that. Litigate. That's who I am.
I know.
That was so funny.
No, I just thought it was kind of boring. I thought it was a whole bunch of stories, but no resolution.
Yeah.
I wanted something more exciting. I don't know. It wasn't what I thought it was going to be, because I had read, the description, and I had wanted to read it for a while, so I was really happy when you picked it, but then I was disappointed.
Hi, Kirsten. It was your book. Were you happy with it?
I think I wanted more, too, but... I mean, I want a sequel. I want to find out what happened to all the people now that he wrote a book about all of them. I would love to see what's Justine Sacco doing?
She's working for DraftKings.
Maybe just a pamphlet.
Yeah. I would love to see. Where are they now?
I'm blown away that none of you went directly to your computers to look for these people. Because their fame was based off the computer.
I didn't look up Justine Sacco. I didn't look up anything else.
Did it come up?
Yeah, of course. Justine Sacco is working for DraftKings. DraftKings is the gambling site that New York Today just outlawed. So that's what Justine Sacco is doing. Yeah, and so that was her job. So she went from there to doing publicity for what is now going to have to be offshore betting. So it's almost like bad karma, bad juju's following around. The little girl who then... By the way, this is one of the things that we skipped over, glazed over, which is the most fascinating thing about this book, was the company that will get rid of your tarnished...
Reputation.com.
You would think more of those companies would be...
Well, they're set up ideally for sex offenders.
Oh, really?
That said that in the book.
Yeah.
It said that for people that are sex offenders, because if you get if you get accused of rape, they want to get that people sometimes then acquitted, but that's what comes up. But you didn't do anything, so they get rid of that. And then they also more unsavory characters that they say they don't accept. I'm sure that money's money. You're about to get a business. Mm-hmm. You got to pay for the roof.
Enormous amount of money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was like six figures for her, wasn't it?
Yeah,
it was a lot.
It was a huge amount of money.
But because of that, now that girl's back on the top. That picture is the first thing that comes up when you Google that girl. So,
it is.
Yeah, because I looked for her, and it was the first thing. I typed her name, and it's her.
But you know what is interesting? It's true. I only look at the first page. I never scroll past the first page either.
Ever.
And I look at the first three. Yes.
Yeah, I'm done.
That's why I did think that was interesting. Well, there's a company that can kind of
share that.
Actually, after reading that book, I started scrolling to the next couple of pages just to see what was there.
Right.
So I was just interested, thinking, are people trying to bury things now?
Because I wonder what happened to that, Cecil the Lion guy. You talk about someone who was totally publicly shamed. You know what I mean? Was scandal. Well, it's happened after this book.
It's so interesting. There was a radio lab called Black Rhino.
I heard that one.
It's so good.
Yeah, that was good.
If you guys aren't on podcasting, you should check out. There's some amazing podcasts.
Really good.
Dan and I listened to the new Serial last night.
Me too.
It's about. Did you listen to it?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. So, but the one about Black Rhino was explaining how this activism, these guys paying money to hunt the one animal they are going to kill anyway. Someone will have to shoot this animal in order to keep the herd going. That money then helps all the other ones. And so, but
and
that
they,
guy got destroyed.
He got destroyed.
And
but
I think that was
so
interesting.
Oh, God.
That was such an interesting
I think he
one.
Broke some laws, too. I think he definitely got off, like, I don't know if he paid for the lion. I don't know. I don't know all the things. That's the other part, is knowing half the facts and just forming an opinion.
That's true.
Exactly.
Reading the headlines.
Yeah. Like, almost the way Sandy does our book club. Sandy. So you read half the book.
Oh, is it our book club now?
Yeah.
I got that too. Club. The ladies' book club.
Yeah. Sandy, what did you think of the book?
I like the subject of the book, but I thought his style of writing was tedious, and it was more reporting. And I said before, it should be like a Vanity Fair article, but then even that, maybe he didn't get accepted with Vanity Fair because it was kind of, Vanity Fair has a lot of dirt.
Right. There's
there was no dirt. It was just like,
fact.
Just facts.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, I could have skimmed through. That's why I didn't finish, because I felt like, okay, got it. All right, yes, I got it.
I felt that a lot, too.
And then the story's like, okay, I read the first, you know, the beginning of it, and then the follow-through was just like, okay, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I felt.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't like his writing.
Seems like he could have had maybe more interesting subjects.
Was it like
stories,
that? Yeah.
But I wonder if,
I'll bet they
not?
Didn't want to go back up to the top. I bet that.
Oh,
I'll bet that
no.
I would love to see his list,
right.
Like personally, his list of who he went after
that's
and who
true.
Said absolutely not. I'm already
it.
On the third page of Google.
Right.
I don't want to get back up to the top.
Right.
No, that's,
you know?
A good point.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I'll bet he had fascinating people that he went after.
Once you get out, well, like once you get out of the conversation, I bet you're like, you know what? That's part of my life I don't want to talk about.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because remember the author that was on Oprah that totally lied.
James Fry.
Yes. Like, he's one that's managed to come back.
That
was
the last time I watched Oprah. I
really?
Hated how she dealt with him in that. I thought she was so inappropriate. Talk about public shaming.
Talk about public shaming.
That was the
I
last
agree.
Time I watched
she
her.
Yeah.
I turned her off.
Yeah.
When
was
I read his book, and I thought it
was
phenomenally written.
Oh,
so
that she
was
lied?
The,
and
yeah,
I
what
guess
was
that he
that?
Made up. I don't think he made up a lot of it. That's the thing. I think he made up two.
Was
he shifted two things.
Yeah.
And she friggin' killed him.
I think he.
Publicly.
I think he just made a mistake. He should have called it a loose autobiography.
Right.
Or
they don't,
nimble,
by the way,
yeah.
After writing an autobiography, they don't have that. They don't
loose.
Have that area in Barnes and Noble.
To call it a fictionalized.
Guys, not totally made believe. So there's a lot of boring parts, but not totally true.
It was not an autobiography. It was a memoir.
Yeah.
And a memoir
right.
has looser. You can be looser with a memoir than
right.
an autobiography. Autobiography is fact based.
Right.
A memoir is like memory based. So the only problem is he should have just stayed true to the actual event. I mean, she killed herself one way. He's reported it another way.
So was it shit or was it diarrhea?
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, you go,
I mean,
no.
Day,
well, here, hold on.
Herself,
you go through. No.
What,
No. You go through with a lawyer. And they read your book and they literally go page by page.
That's right.
And it takes 4 hours and they're like, all right here you said this. Like in my book I described the guy in the last chapter. Don't say his name because I don't know what if I put his name in there. I think I wrote Danny, right? And I described these tattoos he had, and they were like, take those out. I said what? And they're like, those are because
they're so identified.
Now you just described the person. And I was like, but wait. I'm sure lots of people like, no. You said his name and you showed the tattoos. You showed the tattoos. Take the tattoos out. And I was like, wait, then how do I? They're like, and then the lawyer writes it for you. He's like, say ... And I said, all right. And so he goes, all right, I'll change it right now. So I sat in a bed in New York laying there. It was so long. And he just went through every page of my book and everything.
Is vetted, right? And
so James Fry definitely sat with a lawyer.
Yeah.
Or how that.
But maybe he lied to the lawyer.
Okay.
Oh, well, he definitely did claim. That's how it got on paper.
Yeah.
But the public shaming of that guy, I felt. She called him up there to publicly shame him and to rip him apart. And I thought that was so counter to who she proclaims herself
yeah.
to.
Yeah,
right.
But I think that's the best.
I see one of those people yeah. that seems like she just wants, is so just.
Think she can do anything.
She pays someone to look at her toilet paper after she wipes.
What?
Did you know that?
No.
Oprah pays someone to look at her toilet paper after she don't want to look
you
at
are
it.
So
she goes,
full of
she
shit.
Goes this. No, she goes, take it.
You are so full of shit.
I'm lying.
Is it Stedman?
No, I'm joking. I'm joking, but she does seem like someone who, like one of those people that would be impervious to, like, public shame. Because she just is so, like, nah, I'm Oprah. What are you fucking talking about?
Yeah.
I'm Oprah. I wonder if I've been in this shot at all. I think I'm out of it entirely.
I don't know. You know what? She did apologize to him for the way she treated him. She brought him back on and apologized and said, I handled myself very inappropriately.
Well, that's good.
She's another, yeah. So then I was like, okay, I'll watch OWN.
But I'm not else, watching OWN. You know who else did that? Ike Turner. Let me tell you something.
I think she was. I watched it because I was so mad that she'd done
well,
that.
Well, maybe
because
she got a lot of like fan mails.
I couldn't believe
that.
How she behaved. Mm-hmm. I was. It actually broke my heart a little bit because I really admired her.
Mm-hmm.
And when that happened, I went, "That you are not who you say you are.
Right.
Yeah.
The person you've been showing me is not right. So I don't believe anything you say now. Just like you don't believe anything he said because
right.
he changed one part. Yep. Now you've shown me this part of who you are. So you're the same as James Fry. So I'm not watching you. Click. Whatever.
Way to go,
okay.
Leanne.
Right.
And so now, Leanne, what did you think of the book, Leanne?
I said I was the first one to say it.
Oh, yeah. You did?
Yeah, yes. I was the first one.
What'd you say?
I said that it left me, like,
okay.
wanting to go down one more layer. I wanted to go down one layer deeper and, like, get into more of the psychology of what was going on.
Her Twitter account was better
her
than
Twitter.
This book.
Her Twitter account is better than her book.
Awesome.
Sandy, if you
oh
want,
gosh.
I'll put that Twitter account on you, your phone, and you can tweet from there.
No,
and that'll be the official handle of this book club.
It'll be fakey make believe.
We gotta get fake. I'm gonna buy fakey make believe right now, and that'll be Sandy's Twitter. Do you guys want to all create Twitter's accounts so we can do this once a week?
No.
What's our next book?
What is it?
Yeah, Lynn.
Oh,
Lynn. Oh,
fuck.
Shit. You're not invited.
Boring in the time
wait.
Of boring.
Our next meeting is for Seabiscuit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we are not going to film
next
that one.
Next meeting for... Why?
Seabiscuit? We
such
all
a
saw the movie.
It's a phenomenal book.
Yeah.
Tobey Maguire was great.
No, yeah. The book is so much
yeah.
better.
Yeah,
so the book's amazing.
Okay, wait. So when's book club for Seabiscuit?
It'll be probably...
Over the break.
And then what's the one after that, Lynn? What book are you looking at?
I was...
And is this up for a vote?
No,
we can
invite our listeners. It's a totalitarian.
We can invite our listeners to read Seabiscuit.
Guys,
Seabiscuit, Matt, what's her name? Laura Hillenbrand?
Hillenbrand, yeah.
Okay, I'll tell you what, guys. How long is a Seabiscuit book?
That's
Sandy and I are still taking a bath on the
yeah.
last
yeah.
one.
Have you started
Seabiscuit?
Yes, I did.
Do you not like it?
No, I like it.
Oh, okay.
I saw the movie, too.
It's so much better than the movie.
Oh
my
yeah.
god.
Well, Sandy and I'll be the judge of that. We'll watch the movie, you guys read the book, and we'll compare notes. Okay? Sandy, we'll watch Seabiscuit,
yeah.
they'll
okay.
read the book, and then we'll compare notes. And if you guys want,
you can
read.
You can watch
Seabiscuit
with subtitles. English is not your
yes,
first
language.
When did I eat the horse?
And then we'll do podcast.
We'll do podcast?
No, you don't. Watch it.
Oh, yeah, we'll do a podcast, Sandy. By the way, for the record, that's one of the things I edit out. That's one of the things I don't share on social media. But, yeah, and then if you guys want, read Seabiscuit or watch the movie and send all your questions to Leanne's pussy. Just put it in her box and we will read questions from Leanne's pussy.
Oh my god.
And we will read the questions you have about this book. I'm posting it right now. I gotta change this. I gotta change and Sandy's email address is Sandy's fakey make bereave.
Bereave with an R.
Bereave.
Yeah, make bereave.
All right.
What is the next book?
Right,
Lynn,
I thought that we would maybe go back to like some of the classics, and I thought.
Oh fucking!
What?
No, it's an interesting.
Is it in English?
It's actually in.
It's Tolstoy.
English.
It's Tolstoy.
Oh,
it's Lord of the Flies.
Oh, that's
ooh.
A good one.
Yeah, Sandy, I
haven't
read
that
one. Don't worry.
Like,
they made a movie of it.
Yeah.
It's
I think
fine.
As an
yeah.
adult,
yes,
I don't understand
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Oh, there's definitely clip notes.
Lord of the Flies. I'm so happy. That's going to be good. It's not a very long book.
No, that would be a good
one. Wait, how
did
you not read this book?
It's not Everybody, if you went through the educational system in the United States. Didn't.
Yeah, how did you
or
not
Canada.
Read this book?
No, or Canada. You read it.
You did. It's just
in high school
long time
or earlier.
It was a required meeting.
Not in Vietnam.
But you weren't in Vietnam.
You were here.
She doesn't care. That's her excuse for everything.
Sandy, they made a movie of it. It's cool.
But I bet it's been translated into Cantonese. So you could probably find a Cantonese movie.
Wait, can you read Cantonese?
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Chinese. It's not called Cantonese. It's like, you know, can you read? It's like, can you read Oriental?
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to be offensive.
Way to go again. Gotta edit that out now.
Land
dropping.
Yeah. I was trying to be nice.
Dropping C-bombs over here.
Sorry. I didn't know I was being racist.
No, I'm just kidding.
She's giving you shit.
Yeah, she's shaming you.
She's shaming you.
I didn't mean to shame you.
I'll respond in the comment.
You'll respond to Leanne's pussy.
Yeah, I'll respond to that.
Seabiscuit, everybody. That's next week.
And Lord of the Flies.
And then Lord of the Flies
after that. So you gotta.
It's not next week.
I can't read
during
that
the break.
As soon as I'm done reading it.
It's in like 2 weeks or so.
As soon as I'm done reading it. And so you guys start reading Seabiscuit right now. Which is there just one Seabiscuit book?
There's only
one.
Yeah.
Well, it's by Laura Hillenbrand.
Get that right on there, yeah.
Lauren Hill?
Laura Hillenbrand. No. Hillenbrand.
The one who wrote Unbroken.
She wrote Unbroken.
Yeah. A boring book.
What? No, that was
fabulous. Let me rephrase that. Boring movie. It was a bad movie. I didn't like the movie.
What?
The book was amazing.
All I could think the entire time was, pretty convenient that this comes out now when all the people that could have fact-checked this are dead. Interesting. Yeah, I bet I could have a really amazing life if everyone was now dead and didn't use the internet.
Okay, how do we wrap up this podcast?
To say goodbye, Leanne.
Goodbye, Leanne.
Do you guys have anything you want to promote? Pick up? No. What time are you doing pick up?
The Colfax Holiday Boutique.
Okay. Don't say the name of our fucking school. Leanne, don't.
You gotta go? Okay.
You gotta go?
Where are you going? I got shit to do.
It's almost
11.
Oh, it is?
Oh, Christmas. It's going to be 11.
Post office.
All
right,
thank you for breakfast.
All right. That's it, everybody. Have a great day.
I
love you. Go to Bert.com and buy a Bert shirt.
Okay, bye, guys. Thank you.
Happy Bert.
Here, I'll put roll too.
Post roll? What's that mean?
That means after your podcast, you have to stay.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So, again, if you want to listen to it, Audible has it. With more than 180,000 audiobooks and spoken word products, you'll find what you're looking for. So get a free audiobook and a 30-day trial today by signing up at www.audiblepodcast.com/Bertcast. Again, that's www.audiblepodcast.com/Bertcast.
And check out my vlog on my YouTube page. Just go to BertBertBert.com and you can find all my shit there. But go to BertBertBert.com and go shopping through our Amazon banner on BertCast.com. All right. Have a great, great, great rest of your weekend. All right? You know this. I don't need to say it. But I'll say it anyway. This episode was brought to you by The Machine.